Okay. Hopefully we'll be able to finish this before Maariv, so let's we'll get started as soon as we can. Okay, so the question is, you're brushing teeth on Shabbos and Yom Tov. Unfortunately, I do not have a yes or no answer. Otherwise, it'd be much shorter. Okay, so I'm going to go from that which is easiest to that which is hardest, meaning to say, I'm going to start with that which is most easy to permit, and then slowly progress to that which is more and more difficult to permit. Now, I say difficult to permit because at the end, we'll see at least certain ways in which, if a person does it properly, it could be, in theory, permitted, at least according to many opinions. So I'm going to progress all the way to the top, and then we'll kind of figure out where you want to put yourself or where we will put ourselves. Yeah. So the easiest to permit is to begin with the easiest thing, which is mouthwash. So what could potentially be the problem with mouthwash? On Shabbos, there's an isser called noilad. Noilad literally means give birth. So on Shabbos is a prohibition in creating the status of something. When something is born, when you create a certain scenario. The classic example is, the basic noilad is when you take a solid and turn it into a liquid by intentionally melting something. We're not going to get into those laws, but that's the general idea of noilad. You've created now a liquid, which didn't exist before, sorry? Moiled is always an isser. Included in that is the isser of moiled of smell, which means to say, if creating a smell. Sorry? Noiled. Noilad. Nolad. Mashi nolad. I'm using Talmudic vernacular. Noiled, but it's nolad. Yes, to give birth to something. Something's born. So you've created a status of liquid. So the same thing applies to creating the status of smell. If you create a smell, that in and of itself is a prohibition, whether it's rabbinic or biblical, but it's a prohibition nonetheless. Now, generally speaking, it's recording, leave it. Come on. Huh? Okay. Generally speaking, there's a rule called psikresha. Psikresha literally means, it's a little graphic, it means literally removing a head. That's what it literally means. And the Gemara is using it as a hyperbolic way of saying that a person can say, well, I didn't mean to kill the chicken, I just mean to take the head. If you take a head, you're going to kill the chicken. So it's a way of saying that when something happens automatically, you can't claim, I didn't mean for it to happen. So in this scenario, if I wash my mouth, one could argue that, well, I didn't intend to make a good smell in my mouth, I just intend to clean it. But you can't clean without making that smell. That's psikresha. However, the Alter Rebbe proves very extensively, and this is accepted universally, that when it comes to the issue of creating a smell, we go by your intention, not the result. So even though the result is that you've created a good smell in your mouth by using mouthwash, if your intention is cleaning, or even if your intention is to remove a bad smell, then it's okay. Even though, as a byproduct, an inevitable byproduct, this psikresha, you will have a good smell. So this is the baseline. That anytime you're cleaning your teeth, you're making a good smell, unless you're using odorless toothpaste, I suppose. And one has to be honest with oneself. Am I doing this because I like the minty flavor and I like the minty smell? In which case, it would be prohibited, because you're intentionally creating a smell under the category of noilad. One has to be honest and say, I'm doing this because I don't want to get a shoal with bad breath. If that's the reason, in theory, the same thing. But if your intention is in eating gum because you like the smell, it'll be a problem. But if your intention is like the flavor, then it's a byproduct, and it's okay. So that's the first thing, that when one is putting a good smell into their mouth, it cannot be with the intention of the good smell. And again, only you and God know what you had in mind. So that's the easiest thing to permit. Mouthwash with the caveat that we're doing it not with the intention of creating a smell, but rather just to get rid of the negative smell. From there, we move on to, if I were to brush my teeth using a brush, but I'm not using any water or any liquid, starting with the easiest. There are those that want to forbid that too, using a brush, even if you don't use any water or liquid or toothpaste. Reason? Because it's likely that you'll start to bleed. If that's the case, there's a prohibition against making a makkah, making a bruise on oneself or on somebody else on Shabbos, generally speaking, but specifically on Shabbos. And therefore, there are those that want to prohibit brushing teeth, period, even without water, even without liquid, which we'll see soon raises other issues, simply because you're likely to cause yourself to bleed. However, I think the majority, I haven't read every single halakhic authority, but it seems to me that the majority would be on the side of, depends on the reality. If you're the kind of person, every time you brush your teeth, you bleed, then that's a problem. But if one brushes their teeth every day, doctor, they shouldn't bleed. Yes and no. There you go. So if you're the kind of person who, when you brush your teeth, you bleed, and that's expected to happen. So here's where we actually... So this is actually where you do apply the psikadesha. The psikadesha, that is to say, you would count you liable for an inevitable, because you're expecting the bleed to happen, even though you don't want it, you just want cleansing. But because it's inevitable, you're liable for that. When it came to the smell, we said it's a special ruling that when it comes to creating smell, we don't care about the inevitable. We only care about your intention. But ordinarily, the inevitable does apply. And therefore, if it's inevitable that you're going to bleed when you brush your teeth, you cannot brush your teeth. So now we've gone, progressed forward, but we need to keep everything in mind still. So even as we progress, you need to keep in mind that you can't do it with the intention of creating a smell. You also have to bear in mind that if you're going to brush your teeth, you're not the kind of person who ordinarily bleeds. Now from there, we get to using a brush with water without toothpaste. We're progressively getting cleaner. So I've used a toothbrush with toothbrush with water without toothpaste. Many, including the Igros Moshe and others, Rabbi Moshe Feinstein and others, prohibit this on the basis of a prohibition called Srita. Srita, it's hard to translate, but it's something wrong with squeezing the microphone. Well, the microphone's a muktzah, but squeezing the paper. Srita specifically is to like wrangle, is to remove water that was... Ring is the right word. To remove liquid that was in a solid. That's what srita is. It's a prohibition to remove liquid that's in a solid. So if something absorbs liquid, you cannot wring it out. So if this brush absorbed the water, then when you brush it, you are inevitably squeezing the water out and thus in violation. Some opinions. Others, however, disagree and write that if you look, including by Auerbach and others, if you look closely at a brush, especially if you have one that has nylon strands, then it's not so much that the water is absorbed inside of the actual material of the brush, it's just that it's held between there. So it's kind of like having water in a bottle, just very tiny bottles. When you only say srita, you only say wringing out the prohibition if it's like a towel, which absorbs the water, and now you're squeezing it out. A brush never doesn't really absorb the water. This is what others argue. Rabbi Farkash, who is a Lubavitcher Rav, lives in Yerushalayim, a big scholar, big paisik, who has a fantastic book on the laws of Nida and the laws of Shabbos and other books. And he writes, and this is, he's got, I guess, broad enough shoulders to say this, that even those who prohibit, like Rabbi Feinstein and others, who prohibit using a brush with water on the grounds that it is wringing out the water when you're brushing, he says that it's likely because they haven't seen the modern brushes where the water is not absorbed. I suppose if you have the older brushes, which are very tightly pressed like hair-type materials, then it would be considered, arguably at least, because even that's complicated, whether wringing out hair is considered srita. Right, but even if you, let's say you got your beard wet and you wringed out your beard, is that considered srita or not? Is that considered wringing on Shabbos? That itself is a question, which we'll leave empty for now. Sorry? So you have to look at your brush. You have to look. It's not about when it was made, but you have to look at the kind of brush you have. If it's the kind of brush where it's very tightly, all the strands are very tight, and there are, right? So, and therefore, if Rabbi Farkash is basically arguing that if you're going to use a brush that clearly does not absorb the water, just holds it in there like a bottle does, Then Rabbi Farkash is arguing that even those who prohibit on the grounds of ringing would permit it under with that kind of brush. So we've progressed even forward, right? Starting from the top, if you're going to use mouthwash, you can't have the intention of creating a smell. You have to make sure you don't bleed. And then if you're going to use water, you have to make sure it's the kind of brush that doesn't retain, that doesn't absorb the water in the sense that you'd be wringing it out. We're progressing here. Now we get to... I don't know what standard is. If I have to ask the dentist what standard would be, but if you have like the nylon ones, right? But if the bristles are, the truth is that even if the bristles are very tight, like I mentioned, it's a complicated halacha. How all these sages got to these conclusions, I haven't told you yet. I just told you the facts, right? It's complicated to get to each one of these things because even when it comes to, for example, hair, let's say tightly together, and you're wringing out your hair, it's a question whether or not that's even considered wringing it out. But let's just assume that it is prohibited to do that. Then the same thing would apply to your toothbrush if it's so tightly made, if the bristles are so tight together. Sorry? There are? You're asking or you're saying there? I assume there are. Oh, really? Of course there are. I should have known that. So they have thicker rubber... rubbers that they don't. That's very good. There you go. So they're doing that for this reason. They're making it clear that the brush is not absorbing the water to the point that you would be wringing it out. Okay. So we have two last points, and we can get to Marv. Sorry, I don't know. I just found out that they exist. All right. Finally, we have toothbrush with toothpaste. Now, when it comes to the toothpaste, in addition to all the other previously mentioned issues that you have to avoid, we have the final issue, which is memarech. Memarech is one of the 39. Prohibited works is it's the original is to smooth out a surface. I'm giving this background specifically because it's going to be important. The original comes from, sorry? Not polishing, but it comes from, that's a derivative of that. The original is if you're smoothing out a leather hide. When you're preparing hide for leather, you would smooth it out. You would scrape it by smoothing it. So as a result of that, other forms of smoothing out have become prohibited. But here again, so on the grounds of that, many prohibit using toothpaste on a toothbrush because you're smoothing out the paste on your smearing. Yep. But I'm using the word smoothing in a moment. You'll understand why, that you're smoothing out the toothpaste all over your teeth. However, there are those that permit it, and included in that, just for those who want to have Lubavitch cred, is Rabbi Chaim Noah, which is the Ktzois HaShulchan, famous Lubavitcher Rav, big Paisik, who everybody quotes. He permits using toothpaste and says it's not memarech, it's not considered smoothing out because smoothing out is only when the desire of the object of why you're smoothing it out, because you want the smooth result, you want the spread. Like if you were to take a... the classic example is taking a cream and putting it on a bruise in which you want the cream to remain, to completely cover the entire surface of the wound. When you're brushing your teeth, you're not exactly looking in the mirror to make sure that there's a nice coat of toothpaste on your teeth. You're brushing it and rinsing it out. So you're not keeping the smoothing effect that you've done, rendering it not fully a prohibition of smoothing. Many argue that that's the case. So we've progressed all the way. I want to add, though, however, that many of the modern halakhic writers have been mixing quoting from the previous generation and our generation. Specifically in our generation, Rabbi Farkash is one example, and Rabbi Neubart, who's the student of Rabbi Auerbach and Shmuel Shabbat Halacha, is another example, who write that even though I just listed to you the manner in which it would be permissible to use toothbrush and toothpaste because... so long as you're not going to bleed, so long as it's thick enough that you're not wringing out the liquid, and so long as you don't want the smell, you just want to clean, and there's no issue of memarech, you're not smoothing out because you're rinsing it and washing out. Many of the modern poskim write, quote, the custom has become not to use toothpaste. And Rabbi Farkash, in fact, in his introduction, in a footnote at the beginning of his whole discussion on cleaning your teeth, writes, I'm not even getting to the discussion of toothpaste because it's become the custom not to use it. And Rabbi Neubart actually goes so far as to say that the custom is not to brush teeth, period. So He says custom is to brush teeth, but without toothpaste. He says custom is not to brush at all. Just telling you the levels that are available. And final word. Yeah? Brush using mouthwash. Oh, so that would be like using water. There was one level of people who allowed using water, so long as you're not, the intention is not the smell. No, but in terms of the issue of smoothing out, it's the same thing as water, right? So from a halachic perspective, it's the same thing. In other words, so if you're going to go with using water and toothbrush, might as well use mouthwash and toothpaste. Mouthwash and toothbrush would be the same halachic status, if you will, so long as your intention is not to create a smell, right? Getting back to that caveat. It's not. Because toothpaste, there are those, including Rabbi Feinstein, who say it's memarech, it's smoothing out. Sorry? Oh, from a dental perspective, I don't know if that's the doctor here. Okay, so final word. Final word. Number one, there are those that write you should have a unique toothbrush for Shabbos, if you are going to use one, to make a distinction that this is not a weekday behavior. I'm changing it differently because it's Shabbos. This Lubavitcher from Yerushalayim, who I mentioned earlier, who allows using toothpaste, says to put the toothpaste onto your teeth and then brush, rather than put it onto the brush, making it less smoothing out. A, B, you're making a change from weekday, thus separating it from your weekday activity. And finally, Rabbi, I think actually Rabbi Moshe Feinstein writes this as well, but certainly Rabbi Avadya Yosef and others write, not to, I think even Rabbi Feinstein writes this as well. Yes, that's correct. That after brushing the teeth, one shouldn't wash off their toothbrush because that would be preparing for tomorrow's brush. And one does not prepare on Shabbos for the weekday. So, yeah. So here you have, sorry? That's correct. So if you wanted to go, sorry? Yes, Rabbi Chaim also writes. No, Rabbi Chaim does not write that. Doesn't mention that point, I don't think. He mentions putting the toothpaste onto the teeth first and then using the brush. He doesn't mention yes or no. I don't think, one second, let me double check, but I don't think he mentions either way. I don't think he mentions it at all. Here we are. One second. Oh, that's a good point. The soap, is liquid soap different than toothpaste? And the truth is, it's not. And in fact, this Rabbi Neubart, who I mentioned earlier, who says that the custom is not to brush the teeth, in a footnote he says, with respect to toothpaste, go see what I wrote to you about liquid soap. And by liquid soap, he says, it's fine. So he's telling you, he tells you that it's custom not to do it. And the footnote says, wink, by the way, I wrote there that it's okay to use liquid soap, and that's the same thing as toothpaste. So it's almost like he's saying the custom is not to, but maybe you are allowed to. At any rate, just to conclude this, if you were to do it, again, there's all these different levels. People don't do it all, and people just use without any liquid at all. Those use just water rather than toothpaste, and those use toothpaste. If you are going to go all the way to the most lenient, here's what you have to keep in mind. Number one, you're honest in that you're not doing it to create a smell. You're doing it just to clean, one. Number two, ideally, you should have a separate Shabbos toothbrush. Number three, that toothbrush should be the kind that does not absorb water, rather just holds water in there. Number four, like Rabbi Chaim Noah writes, you should put the toothpaste onto your teeth first and then brush. And number five, when you're done using it, don't clean it out because that would be preparing for Sunday. Well, thank you. Yeah?
Toothpaste on your finger.
What about it? No, the point is to make a distinction between the rest of the week. That's the point. Rest of the week, you put it onto the toothpaste. It would have the same problem. It would have the same memarech. It would have the same smoothing issue.
Right.
Not this. It would have the same issue.
You might as well use the brush.
Right, but the point is, yes, all the issues still apply there.
The idea is to avoid the squeezing business.
No, the reason why you're putting it on your finger is just to make it to distinguish it from weekday. Nothing to do with squeezing. To distinguish the behavior from the weekday. That's all.
Well,
all right, Meyer, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.